Good morning, everybody. Thank you very much for dialing in today. This is our latest webinar on My Electric Avenue. My Electric Avenue is a three-year LCNF project looking at the potential impact of electric vehicles on low-voltage networks. And today, specifically, we'll be looking at the implementation aspects of Esprit control, the benefits of that, and the potential impacts as well. The session today is going to be hosted by Dr. Nando Ochoa and Dr. Jairo Kouros-Tortos from University of Manchester. They're our project partners on My Electric Avenue. They are going to be delivering, as part of the project, an assessment of the technical benefits of Esprit to low voltage networks. So I'm going to pass over now to Nando and let him explain a little bit more about what they've been working on.
Excellent. Good morning, everyone. Your lines have been muted. So you will not be able to hear anyone else apart from us, ourselves. I'm here with Dr. Jairo Kouros, and my name is Nando Ochoa, part of the University of Manchester. I'm going to start with the presentation here that we have in general around 30 minutes for the presentation, and then we will go into 10 minutes of approximately some questions from you. I will have some people that will be joining us in the last few minutes. Please use the chat box to provide any question that you might have. So we don't wait until the very end just for questions. So any question that you have in the meantime, we will answer them at the very end, but please use the chat box just to record that and then we can answer them. Okay, so this is the overview slide. First, I'm going to present very quickly the motivation of the My Electric Avenue project, and very quickly as well, some analysis that we did on the data that we have been collecting from the cars. It's the car wins data. This is the name that Nissan uses for the data collection that they do. Then I will pass on the presentation to Dr. Hughes. First, we will be presenting the low voltage meters that we're modeling, part of the project and as well part of another project that came from Electricity Northwest. We will present the corresponding impact studies, and finally we will present some implementations of the Esprit technology or the philosophy, and this is the actual control of the electric vehicles. So in general, what is the motivation? Why are we doing this? The expectation is that according to the different scenarios that DEC has produced, based as well on the scenarios that National Grid has produced just a few years ago, we are likely to have a significant uptake of electric vehicles. So we are talking about plug-in hybrids and fully plug-in electric vehicles. Now, these numbers, when you look at the y-axis in terms of the millions, they might look significant, and they are if we look at 2030. But we have to remember that right now we have around 30-something million cars as well in vehicles. So in the next 10 years, if you want, the numbers are not going to be massive. Nonetheless, the problem is not necessarily on the overall numbers, but the fact that these cars can be connected in low voltage meters, in our houses, and the moment that we have clusters, we might have problems. And the question is, how do we solve these problems? So that was the idea behind this low carbon networks fund project. It is run by Yale Technology and it's called Scotland Power Energy. We have other partners as well, including Northern Power Grid. The aim is to investigate these particular impacts and the control technology on around 9 LV feeders, and we have around 100 electric vehicles that are going to be actually managed. Nonetheless, we also have some other interesting things. So in this slide now, what you can see here is a map of Britain. And on the blue point, we have the 100 plus trials. So these are electric vehicles that are being monitored, but we are not managing. However, this is very, very interesting data. The red point that you can see in the area of Northern Power Grid, Energy, Power Distribution, are the 100-plus clinical trials. So these are cars that we are also monitoring, but also the charging points at homes are being managed. Now, before we start into the details of the actual low voltage feeders and how this impact actually, how big can they be in terms of the different penetrations of electric vehicles, we need to understand first how these electric vehicles are going to be behaving. So what we did was an analysis of this car wins data that comes from the cars, particularly. And what we found after a year of analysis is that, first of all, there are not many changes between seasons, so they behave very, very similarly, which is quite interesting. Also, what we found is after 2 or 3 weeks, most of the users start having a repetitive pattern, so which means after 2 or 3 weeks, they start behaving as is a normal car, which is actually interesting news as well. But in terms of when do they connect and how often, well, that was also interesting for the technical aspect. So here this graph shows the, so don't we have everyone muted? I guess so. Anyways, sorry about that. There's someone is having some connection here. But back to this presentation. So here, the number of connections we're showing really is that most of the people, either during a weekday or a week weekend, is around one connection per day. Some people, however, in one day can actually have up to 10 connections, and that's quite interesting. But in general, what we're seeing is 1 or 2 connections per day, rather than the typical, perhaps, what some reports have shown that people will connect once a day. No, it's actually twice, perhaps. Now, in terms of when do people connect, this graph, Car Wins Analysis 3-5, what it shows is that during the weekdays, people are likely to connect during the morning and during the evening. And this is perhaps as expected, the evening part, but the morning part was something that we were not expecting. And this is just because obviously we're collecting data of real people using these cars. During the weekend, however, these connections, or the time of these connections happen throughout the day, because obviously we have very, very different patterns. Now, in terms of the initial charging level, so this is when people connect, they connect when they have the battery depleted, or the battery is almost fully charged. How do they do it? So that, what is this graph is showing? This is the initial charge level. So essentially, remembering that the Nissan Leaf has the battery divided into 12 units, and that's what it is showing in the dashboard of the car. So this graph is showing that essentially people connect the car to recharge the battery at any point of the battery. So some of them connect it even when it is almost fully charged, and some of them connected when it is almost depleted, which is again interesting, but this is extremely useful information for us to model the corresponding behavior of the cars. Finally, what would be this final charging level? So essentially what we learned is that most people leave the car connected until it reaches the full charge. Perhaps as expected, but it is interesting to have this formal quantification after a year of analysis of these trials, either during the weekend or during the week. So this was a very, very quick overview of the project, particularly as well the car wins data that we are processing that then will be used for the analysis of the networks. I will pass on this presentation to Dr. Kios.
Good morning, everyone. Continuing with Nando's presentation, in the My Electric Avenue project, investigating the impacts of residential low voltage feeders and also commercial low voltage feeders. In the context of residential low voltage feeders, these figures shows the application of the or what is actually being fired today in the My Electric Avenue project. In the context of My Electric Avenue project, we have sensors at the head of the feeders and charging points at the houses that have an electric vehicle. These charging points are communicated with the switch station through some communication channels, power line carrier, and they are controlled, as I will present later in this presentation, through signals, control signals, that basically determine whether the car is connected or not. I will go into details later in the presentation. In the context of My Electric Avenue, we are considering Nissan Leaf, which is also a partner in the project, and their characteristics. The characteristics of the electric vehicles are shown in the bottom of this slide. In particular case, it is important to know that 3.3 kilowatts are demanded. This is a slow charging mode according to this standard. In the context of my electric cabinet project, there are nine residential LV feeders and one commercial LV feeder. Four residential LV feeders belong to Northern Power Grid and the other five to SPP. Nando previously highlighted where they are located, and this table on the bottom of this slide shows the main characteristics of these LV feeders. Highlighted in this figure is the Courtney Road LV feeder, whose topology can be seen in the top figure. As we can observe, this is a very long feeder that feeds approximately 150 customers. This particular feeder is located in SSCPD area, in the south. And it has been highlighted because we are going to analyze and go into details on the impacts of electric in this specific feeder. In the My Electric Avenue project, we are also using representative feeders. And this analysis aims to generalize or provide more details into a more diverse residential LV feeders population. For this particular analysis, we are using results from the Low Voltage Network Solutions project, which is a project led by ENW Electricity Northwest, which is the DNO in the northwest of England. More details of the creation of these representative feeders can be seen in the reports that have been publicly available, and the references are at the bottom of this slide. In particular, we're going to look at the feeder 6, which is a very long feeder and highly populated feeder, whose topology can be seen in this slide. So, once we have created these networks, which have also been validated against monitor data, and on top of that, we have the EV profiles that have been created using the Carwin data that Nando previously detailed, we also need to model the residential demand. And to do this, we are using the CREST tool. The CREST tool is a very powerful tool created in Loughborough University that allows us to model the demand of each house. So once we have the model of the network, validated model of the network, plus the residential load profile, plus the EV profiles, then we are able to run time series three-phase power flow results, analyze three time series three-phase power flow results. And this is done using OpenDSS, an open source software that is developed by EPRI USA. Once we have this methodology to assess the impacts of electric vehicles, we can do it for different penetration levels. Here, a penetration level indicates the number of houses that possess the technology, in this case, the electric vehicle. For the base case, which is a 0% penetration level, which is what we have in the business as usual case, then we can observe that the single feeder that I previously showed, which feeds 149 houses, doesn't have any thermal issue even during winter time as expected. However, if every house has an electric vehicle, that is a full adoption of the technology, then we can observe in this figure that thermal problems can occur. In this particular example, we can see that the current can be as high as 500 amps. And this represents an utilization factor of about 140%. Here the utilization factor is quantified as the peak demand divided by the capacity of the cable, which in this case is 374 amps. So 500 over 374 is approximately 140%. However, we have now quantified what is the utilization factor of the of this particular feeder for the base case, 0% penetration and 100% penetration. However, what is happening in the middle? What is the penetration level at which we start having thermal problems in this particular LV feeder? As this figure highlights, we can see that a 40% penetration level presents some overload of the cable, a thermal problem occurs. at 40%. Although this might not be significant, this deterministic analysis shows that a problem occurs at 40% penetration level. In this figure, we can also see that we can also investigate the seasonality, and as expected, winter seasons are the worst case scenario, and summer months are the less problematic. In terms of voltages, we can see in this figure that for the base case, the voltage is around the expected value, 424 volts face to face, according to DNO practices. Although it is reduced during peak time due to the residential demand, this is not significant. Crucially, for 100% penetration level, we can see that the voltages decrease significantly compared to the base case. However, the limits are not overpassed. This basically means that voltage problems in this single feeder, which feeds 149 houses, does not present voltage problems for any penetration level. Now, we have done the analysis for this particular LV feeder. However, the results of this LV feeder cannot be extrapolated to all the residential LV feeders that I previously presented. Therefore, we have done the same analysis for every single feeder for every single penetration level in a deterministic way as in the context of the myelectric avenue project. This figure on the left shows that for winter weekdays, up to two feeders might present thermal issues for high penetration levels. More importantly, it shows that voltage problems are not experienced at any penetration level in any LV feeder involved in the myelectric avenue project. In terms of summer and weekdays, the figure on the right shows that up to two feeders as well may have thermal issues. However, as it is evident, the hosting capacity of this feeder, defined as the penetration level that it's able to, that the feeder is able to cope with without any problem, is moved to the right. So we move from 40% to 70%. And this is expected given the demand from the household. But this is in the context of the myelectric avenue project feeders. And then to extend this to all the LVNS feeders, which represent a population of the ENW area, and to some extent, cool perhaps, with some details or with some caveat, can be extrapolated to the population of other DNOs. This figure on the left shows that during winter, we might have up to four feeders out of eight. This is 50% of the feeders that may have thermal issues for very high penetration levels. More importantly, it shows that the MIA feeders previously presented, although they didn't present any voltage problem, some other feeders that represent a large population may have voltage problems for very high penetration levels. And as expected during summer, these problems are less. In an attempt to create a lookup table that shows the hosting capacity of each LVNS feeder, this table shows the penetration level that the feeder will present a problem first. Although this table doesn't show which problem is occurring, it highlights that up to three feeders can present a problem, thermal or voltage, for very low penetration levels, up to 50%. And as expected, this occurs in winter. Moving on and entering a very interesting part, which is the management of electric vehicles in the context of the split philosophy. This figure on the left shows what is the conceptual approach used in the split philosophy. The figure on the right shows what is the implementation of the split philosophy. So as I previously mentioned at the beginning of this presentation, we have a PLC located at the switch station, and this PLC receives information from the sensor at the head of the field, and also information from the car charging points. These charging points basically indicate whether the EV is connected or not, and the PLC takes control actions based on this philosophy, and is designed for the next control cycle what will be the status of each electric vehicle. The figure on the left, coming back to it, shows that if we don't have management, we might have some overloads in this example figure. So the SPRIT philosophy defines or basically determines to curtail some electric vehicles, so like that the feeder current is kept within the limits. The car will be reconnected later on when capacity becomes available in the network. Having in mind this SPRIT philosophy, we have developed here in Manchester a SPRIT-like control. This SPRIT-like control has as a conceptual approach, which is very similar to the SPRIT philosophy, to curtail the demand from electric vehicles when a problem is detected in the network. This managed electric vehicles will be reconnected and resume the charging once capacity becomes available in the network. However, to cater for the unforeseen arrivals of electric vehicles, we have introduced in this SPRIT light control developed by the University of Manchester, security margins that, as I previously highlighted, aim to cater for these cars that may arrive. Although this might sound very simple approach, there are significant challenges that must be overcome. For example, the control strategy must follow a hierarchical approach. This is crucial because problems can occur at the feeder level first. And if a problem occurs at the feeder level and we attempt to solve the problem at the transformer level, we might not solve the problem. Therefore, we have developed a hierarchical corrective disconnection. This hierarchical corrective disconnection goes from the feeder level per phase per feeder to the transformer level. So if a problem is detected at the feeder level, it will be solved at the feeder level first and then at the transformer level. This ensures that all technical problems will be overcome. In this hierarchy control strategy, we have also proposed a hierarchical preventive reconnection. It is preventive because, as I previously mentioned, it considers security margins. And it goes from the transformer level to the feeder level per phase per feeder. And this is important because even though a feeder may have a capacity available to reconnect electric vehicles, perhaps the transformer is not able to cope with one additional electric vehicle. Hence, the hierarchy of the approach. Another big challenge that we face in the development of this control strategy is the number on which electric vehicles will be disconnected and reconnected. This is critical because we don't have information, real-time information about the state of charge of the electric vehicles. So how can we approximate this state of charge? We have introduced different approaches. One of them is the charging time. So for how long the car has been connected. And this charging time is used in the conceptual, in the SPRIT-like control developed in Manchester. Crucially, and to assess the impact of this charging strategy on customers, we have introduced impact metrics. This impact metric, the one that I'm going to present today, refers to the charging delay that is causing the electric cars. And I will go into details in the next slides on this. We have implemented this SPRIT-like control in different networks, and I'm going to present the results of this SPRIT-like control in one real UK LV network. This is operated by the UK DNO Electricity Northwest. It consists of a 500 kVA transformer and 370 customers. To quantify the benefits of the spread light control and also the impacts on customers, we have undertake a probabilistic assessment that is based on a Monte Carlo analysis of 100 simulations. As we can see in this slide, the control strategy is effective and it solves all the congestion problems that would have occurred without the control. So the blue line shows that the transformer loading is kept within 500 kVA, which is the limit of the transformer, for as long as cars arrive at home. The figure on the bottom figure shows that the voltages are also solved due to the management at the transformer level, and they are all kept above the threshold of 0.94 in the case of the UK. In terms of the EV demand, the top figure shows that the EV demand is shifted from peak hours to when capacity becomes available later in the night. More importantly, and to go into the details of how the street light control works, we can see in the bottom figure that if no management is considered, then this car will have been charged from 544 until 2024. That represents 160 minutes of charging time. However, because of the management, this car was disconnected 15 minutes past 7 p.m. and it was later reconnected when capacity became available. Although the charging delay, because this car went from 160 minutes charging time to 389 minutes. And although this charging delay is quite considerable in this particular example, this is not the case of all the electric vehicles, as I will present in the next slide. However, it is important to remember this number, 143.13%, because it is used in the customer impact level that is introduced in the next slide. As we can see in this table, the bottom of the slide, we have introduced 10 different customer impact levels, going from 0 to 9. Here, 0 represents that the customer has not been disconnected at all, and a customer impact level of 9 means that the charging delay has been higher than 200%. If we consider this 143% that we previously saw, then we can conclude that the customer impact level of the EV that we previously saw is 6. If we do this assessment for every single car connected to this specific network, we can see that most of the customers, about 48%, are not disconnected at all during the day. And a lot of them, most of them actually, have a customer impact level lower than 5. This is less than double. However, this figure shows that about 4% of the customers out of 370 might have a significant charging delay. We have done the assessment at the transformer level and customer impact level for different control cycles. Here a control cycle is the time interval between two consecutive control actions. Considering the same network, we can see that 1 minute control cycles totally mitigate the problem. However, we can conclude that 5 and 10 minutes control cycle are equally effective, given that the thermal overload is not significant, and this only occurs for very high penetration levels. And in this particular example, we are considering that the threshold to start disconnecting cars is 100%. We could potentially solve this by decreasing this threshold to 90% and ensuring that the capacity of the transformer will never be overloaded. But these are just potential adaptations of this control that we have proposed. In terms of customer impact level, the top figure shows that for 1 minute control cycle, and for different penetration levels. As the penetration level increases, and as expected, the percentage of customers affected increases. This is expected given that higher penetration levels will mean more cars connected during peak time. The bottom table shows what is the percentage of customers for different control cycles that are not affected. And this figure, this table highlights that 10 minutes and 5 minutes control cycles can significantly increase the customer satisfaction. Because for a 100% penetration level, we could go from 40% of happy customers to 54%. And this represents a 14% of more happy customers. Although we could go for 30 minutes control cycles and increase almost to 20%, as we previously saw, this may have a significant effect on the transport. To conclude this presentation, well, the split technology is definitely an intelligent and cost-effective solution to control electric vehicles. It is quite cost-effective in the sense that it uses limited information. As I previously presented, we only require sensors at the head of the feeder and communications between the PLC at the switch station and the charging points. This practical solution is believed to be more attractive to network operators in the context, in the sense that it is quite implementable and cost-effective to the increasing demand of electric vehicles. The My Electric Avenue trials is able to capture as well the actual EV behavior. This has been demonstrated with the CarWinds data that was initially presented by Nando, in which more than 200 electric vehicles were investigated, and from those 200 plus electric vehicles, we learned how EV demand will be in the future. Crucially, we have also shown that it is critical to understand the impact
Hi everybody, can you hear me? I'm not quite sure what happened then with the sound, but I'm sure Hiro and Anando will be back online very shortly. So in the meantime, I'm going to start answering a couple of the questions that we've had come through so far. So first one that I can see, do you take into account the location on the feeder and the state of charge to select the EVs to charge? Okay, so in terms of Esprit that we have in place, obviously the Esprit-like control that the University of Manchester have been talking about is based on their simulation of the actual curtailment that we've seen happen on the trials. So in terms of the Esprit that's in place at the moment, we we don't, the SPRI algorithm doesn't look at the location of where the vehicle is charging, where our ICB is placed on the phase. However, it does take account of what the current, what the ICB was drawing in terms of current before it goes into a curtailment mode. Therefore, it does, in a way, take account of state of charge, but not in a in terms of percentage of battery. It looks at current drawn before it entered into that mode. I hope that's answered your question. If not, please let me know. Another question. Could you explain the social trials we mentioned? Okay, so we have, with the MyElectric Avenue trials, we've got two trials. We've got the technical trials. These are the people who are literally trialing a piece of technology that we've installed in their house. We've got then the social trials, and they are basically working as a comparison or a control group. So bearing in mind, the technical trial participants, they have been given an electric vehicle for the first time, many of them. And not only are they trying out an EV for the first time, which takes quite a lot of adapting in the way of how you drive and how you manage things like charging things as opposed to petrol and diesel. So we're looking at drawing out the differences between having an EV for the first time and having an EV for the first time and having controlled charging, because those two things, it's easy to get them confused. So that's why we have the social trial, so that we can look at EV charging and driving behavior specifically, so that we can draw out those differences. So just again, the social trials, we have not installed technology in their homes. We are literally collecting data from the vehicles on their charging and driving behavior only. I hope that's answered the question. When modeling the energy shift on EV demand, are you considering any efficiency losses? If so, how much, say in percentage terms? Okay, for this one, I think Nando has come back online, so I'm going to pass over to Nando and let him answer this one. Okay, perhaps he's not online. Okay, so I'll do my best to answer this one for you. So we are looking, as part of the deliverables on the project, we are looking at efficiency losses. I can't say how much in terms of percentage terms. We're also looking at two forms of energy efficiency, just in terms of the network side of things, but also in terms of vehicles. So things like carbon efficiency, we are looking at the difference in terms of number of electric vehicles that we're allowing by using ESPRI, promoting the uptake of electric vehicles, and what sort of impact that might have, as well as looking from the network perspective. I will, if you send me your name, viewer number 18, then I can get back to you with a more detailed answer to your question. My apologies that we can't connect with Nando at the moment to answer that. Okay, another question. The Leaf has a relatively small battery compared to, say, the Tesla. What difference would this make to the findings you describe? Okay, so as I understand it, the Tesla charges at almost twice the rate as the Leaf. So we're talking 3.3 to 3.5 kilowatt charging, and the Tesla charges, from what I believe, at 7 kilowatts, or roughly there or thereabouts. So in terms of the findings, I guess you're looking at double the amount of impact potentially. Once again, I would have to draw out, I'd have to ask Nando and Jairo to have a look at the results that they've got to be able to provide a much more detailed answer. But roughly speaking, you're looking at double the impact. I can't see any further questions at the moment. So has anybody got any further questions that they'd like to ask at this point? If there's anything specific to what Nando and Jairo have talked about, I can by all means pass that on to them. As long as you let me know your name, then I can get back to you with a detailed answer. Okay, so nothing's come through at the moment, and as it's 11:40, I'm going to say that, one more question, beg your pardon. EV users were chosen randomly, which means they were connected to any phase on the feeder. How would this affect the phase imbalance issues? That's a very good point. Nando has tried to join us again, so I'm going to try once more to connect and pass that question over to Nando. No, just doesn't look like that's going to happen, unfortunately. The technology is letting us down today. Okay, so in that case, I will get back to you with an answer on that. Thanks very much for all your questions, and thank you so much for calling in today. I hope it was informative and useful, and look forward to our next webinar. If you have any other questions or anything else you'd like to ask, by all means, please follow up and email us at myelectricavenue@eatechnology.com. Otherwise, thank you very much, and have a great day. Thank you.